And we've also seen this just enacted in the EU in France under the Hadopi banner. After three or four attempts to enact it in law, and after the European Courts of Justice and the High French Court said that this violated human rights norms to take away your internet access without a judiciary, Sarkozy basically created a kangaroo court through which you would have a 2 to 5 minute opportunity to defend yourself before your network connection was taken away from you, and this is a proposal across the EU. There's some indication that it may sneak into the next Canadian copyright bill, and we have to ask ourselves, why does all of this stuff take place in secret? Why does it take place out of the public eye? Well, I may flatter myself, but I think that the reason that this isn't being undertaken at the UN, and this was something that was in the Obama administration's memo, is that rights holder groups no longer believe that they can get what they want out of the UN because public interest groups now attend those meetings and disclose the substance of their negotiations. Hence the secrecy of Bill C-60 and Bill C-61. What we discover when we ask the public whether or not we want our information lives conducted on this basis is that the public overwhelmingly doesn't. We like the idea of artists getting paid, we like the idea of a fair and just society, but we don't like the idea of accusation being a basis to bankrupt our children or to enact criminal sanctions or civil sanctions or to take away our network access. Indeed, the Canadian consultation that's just ended shows an overwhelming national support for a more liberal copyright regime and no substantial support for the kind of copyright regime that was proposed the last two times around when we tried to get a copyright bill passed. Now, I'm a rights holder. That's what I do for a living. I write all day long. It's actually one of the great luxuries of my life that I sit in a room and write all day long. It's the kind of thing I've dreamt of doing all my life. And copyright law is critical to how I make my living. And for me, the worst aspect of all of this is that it alienates the public from copyright law. When you hand the public a license agreement that starts with, by reading this document, you agree to the following. You know, I'm allowed to come over to your house and wear your underwear and clean out your fridge and make some long distance phone calls and punch your grandmother. And this can all be changed without notice. And by standing there shouting, no, 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 I don't agree, you have agreed. And then we say, well, actually, you don't need to worry about all that crazy stuff. You just have to worry about these clauses. That's just there in case we ever need it. What we essentially say is that it's meaningless. It can't be interpreted. The stuff that's in the copyright agreement isn't really an agreement at all. We do great violence to the idea of agreement when we say this about the agreements. Do we really want people to believe that they don't need to pay attention to copyright notices? We continue to create DRM even though no customer of mine ever woke up and said, I wish there was a way I could do less with my books. Maybe Adobe's added some DRM to ebooks. If you buy a copy of The Lion King, as I did for my 19-month-old, the deluxe edition that cost £35, you'll find yourself sitting through 25 minutes of business model before the movie starts. If you steal your copy, you don't get any of that. If you bought Sony BMG Music 2 years ago when they were caught putting rootkits, these are malicious software that are used by hackers to take control of your computer. They were caught putting rootkits on millions of CDs. They compromised hundreds of American military and government networks. You got an infection on your computer, one that was extremely hard to remove. If you stole that CD by downloading it without permission and without paying for it, you got no such infection. What this has the net effect of doing is convincing people that copyright law is for suckers and buying stuff is something that people who are not in the know do. And it's not necessary because there are plenty of artists thriving in the digital era, whether it's the Bare Naked Ladies or Madonna, who's moved from a record label to a concert promoter because the more copies there are of Madonna's work, the more her concert tickets are worth, or Jonathan Coulton, the nerd bard, who set out to write a song a week for 52 weeks and release them for free on the internet and now finds himself touring and giving stadium shows. Or whether it's filmmakers like Nina Paley, Michael Moore, or Robert Greenwald who've embraced copying of their works, or writers. My last book, Little Brother, has been 90,000 hardcovers in print in the US, 16 foreign editions in print or forthcoming, New York Times bestseller, film rights sold, stage rights sold, comic rights under negotiation, and so on and so forth. It was available as a free download the day it came out in stores with a license that encouraged and permitted remixing, including translations. And many of the translations I sold were into markets where non-commercial fan translations already existed. So I like Hollywood. I don't want you to get the impression that I don't like it. I like watching robots throw buildings at each other as much as the next guy. My Fulbright was at USC. My local cinemas were the Cinerama Dome and Grauman's Chinese. I was in heaven while I was there. But the entertainment industry has framed this as them or us. The head of Universal says that the internet has been a net negative for society. Ultimately, I don't care if it's good for the entertainment industry or not. We can argue all day long about whether it's good, whether artists can or can't survive in an era in which copying takes place. I don't care even if it turns out that they're right about the need for DRM. I still choose no DRM because it won't work. And because it builds the architecture of control into the information society. I'm a science fiction writer. I write books. So, of course, I go to see science fiction movies so that I can be angry at their writers who make more money than I do but write dumber science than I do. So a fixture in science fiction movies is the rocket ship with the self-destruct button. Someone inevitably hits the self-destruct button and the self-destruct timer starts counting down. And I always think to myself, wouldn't this be a better rocket ship if it wasn't designed to explode? And when I hear someone saying we need to design computers so that they can keep secrets from their users, so that policy can be enforced against them without their knowledge or permission, I say to myself, wouldn't this be a more secure computer, a more fitting vehicle with which to ride into the information age, if it were designed never to keep secrets from its owner, if it were designed never to allow remote policy to be set against its owner without their permission or knowledge? I still say we need liberal copyright. Even if they're right about it being us or them. I don't think they are right. John Philip Sousa in the early 1900s predicted that if the phonogram were allowed to continue, that humanity would lose its voice boxes as we lost our tails when we came down out of the trees. And he was extremely wrong, although he was an early advocate of the still controversial in some quarters theory of natural selection, and I do give him points for that. Jack Valenti in 1982, I beg your pardon, said that the VCR is to the American film industry as the Boston Strangler is to a woman home alone. He was completely wrong. But even if they're right this time around, I still choose us. Because choosing them means legislating in secret. It means wiretapping the network. It means undermining the fundamental principles of justice and due process. We have universal access to all human knowledge in our grasp. We have access to tools and communities and ideas. The internet makes it cheaper and easier to collaborate and work together and solve our problems than it has ever been in all of human history. And that's worth more than 100 film industries or 1,000 record industries. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Corey. You've given us an incredible amount to think about, beginning with the telephone and all the way down. I was especially compelled when I hear about the telephone because I'm so frustrated with mobile telephones. I'm one of those people who believe that AT&T has a place in America called More Places, because that's where the more bars are. They aren't where you are. We have about 10 minutes for questions. If it would be possible to find a microphone, identify yourself if you have a question. Please.
Hello. My question is about a product of the EFF, namely Tor. I think Tor is an awesome product, but it's not perfect. It's very dependent on the end nodes, and some operators of those end nodes have recently been getting in legal trouble for data passing through those nodes that would be considered illegal, like child porn and stuff. My question is, will true anonymity ever hit the web? If so, when? And do you think it will ever become a pervasive element of the web?
So some background here, TOR is the onion router. It was actually a project of the U.S. Office of Naval Intelligence initially, and it was a tool that would enable intelligence officers behind hostile foreign borders to communicate in privacy through national firewalls with their colleagues and with their command structure. The Naval Intelligence open sourced it, and the Electronic Frontier Foundation, my former employer, took over maintenance of it. TOR is what it does is it routes your internet traffic through several hops, each of which knows only the hop that it came from and the hop that it's going to, and not the ultimate destination or the ultimate originator. And this has been an extremely useful exercise in discovering just how easy or hard it is to do anonymity on the web. It's easy to do some anonymity on the web with this stuff. You can certainly defend yourself against moderate attackers like your school's network, but it's a little harder to defend yourself against more resourced attackers like the National Security Agency using Tor. Partly because it looks like a number of the exit nodes, that is to say the nodes that allow you to connect to the actual web and pull documents back, are being operated by governments. The Chinese government operates a lot of them, and it looks like various intelligence groups operate a lot of them. This is a pretty cost-effective way of snaffling up all the supposedly anonymous traffic, even if you can't necessarily trace it back to the originator. Tor needs more work. Tor security is a process, not a product. So Tor worked very well in an environment where there was no Tor. Now that there is Tor, attackers have responded by building Tor-resistant surveillance technologies. We need to build surveillance-resistant next-generation Tor technologies and go back and forth. I don't think we'll ever settle it.